Urban Today, brought to you by
Metropolitan International University. We offer postgraduate diplomas, bachelor's degree, diploma, certificate programs, weekend, day and evening. Registrations in progress at our campuses.
From that wonderful conversation I just had with Christian Newman, you're still watching Urban Today, and we have a whole lot of interesting things to look at and discuss. Yes, the whole crew here now. Henry Sekanjako, Darren Bartlett, and of course Lydia.
That was an interesting debate.
Closely, because...
I think I wouldn't have any problem, you know, as a parent, you know.
You're the father, as we're talking about.
Yeah, my kid accesses a phone at any age. Even if Chris was talking about between the ages of 13 and 15. Mm-hmm. But maybe, you know, we're moving in, you know, a modern society where, you know, gadgets are now part of...
So you would rather expose your children?
And you see, that is the question. What happens when mommy and daddy don't agree on these issues? You know, mommy wants to give the phone and daddy saying, no, my child should have the phone. What do you do?
Now, you guys, let me tell you something. I have seen crime, what I would call cyber crime, that children have gone through. A kid runs away, gets a friend's phone, subscribes to Facebook, and meets people on Facebook who eventually kidnap them or commit crimes on these young girls. And it becomes really bad. That's why I've had those many debates in my head of, at what age will I allow my daughter to go on social media, because I've actually seen these crimes happen and reported. Most times people, and even New Vision reported a story here where of a housemaid who went on Facebook and subscribed, and then eventually lied to the boss that she wants to go to the village. And then what happened was she traveled from here to, I think, Arua, something like that, a place where she doesn't know, she has never met a person. They just met on Facebook. And when we reached there, the guy's phone was off, and she got stranded just like that. So, you guys, I need to say that this has come for us. It's going to be very dangerous for us and for the kids. We just need to talk to our kids the dangers of using social media, and also create more ways for them to engage without necessarily being on social media. Because we've seen how social media has destroyed our lives. We no longer engage physically and have fun and all that kind of thing. But again, I need to stress the fact that social media has caused anxiety. It's causing stress and depression to people. And I encourage all of you to find time and watch a movie called Social Media Dilemma, how algorithms are being used.
There we go. Please speak English.
How the algorithms, now there's no word in Uganda, but it's basically a system that is designed to display information that you're interested in.
Absolutely.
So that system then looks on your Facebook and says, you like talking about sports, it's going to bring people who talk about sports with you and engage with you in the conversations that you usually engage with. So it's called an artificial intelligence that is used to design such things. That's why if I gave you my Facebook and you gave me mine, I may find yours boring because the things you like are very different from mine.
Totally.
Even when we follow the same people, that's the most, you know, weird thing. So what happens is when Facebook realizes, and I'm going to emphasize on Facebook specifically because it's the one that has championed this AI thing.
Yes.
And it's the one that is being sued the most.
Yes.
That every time it realizes it's been a while since you checked your Facebook, it sends you a notification to say, oh, do you want to check out what Lynn has posted today? So because you always comment on Lynn's things, you rush, you click that, because they want to keep you on phone at all times. Now, imagine when the blackout happened here and the lockdown and shutdown of internet. I personally received messages where people were asking me, when you guys work in the media, when are they going to put back this thing? I am stressed. I can read these messages on air,
so
but I may
like
not read.
So people are anti-social now. Everyone is on Facebook.
I don't mind reading these messages because it's very important for you to understand how grave this is going to affect us. And you realize that if they switched off internet today for the next probably 4 or 5 days, we're going to have people commit suicide. This one I can assure you. Listen to this message. Hi, Darren, do you know when the internet is going to come back? I said, no. I said, no, it will depend on the security situation in the country. He said, there's no security threat. I said, this is from a trusted source that is the army that we believe in. He said, I am fed up and I am tired and I am stressed. I don't know what to do. If they do not put back the internet in the next few days, I think I'll run mad. Now that
Just
why? Yes.
That's addictive.
People are very addicted.
Addiction.
Yes.
You know, I was actually having a conversation with Christian Newman before we came here, and he said, look, we human beings have stopped seeking validity from people.
Yeah.
Yes.
When I come here and I don't tell Lydia or Henry or you and say, you're looking beautiful, what you're going to do is going to take a picture and post it on social media.
And wait for the comments.
Yeah,
and some, and for
really
some
nice.
Reason,
yeah.
those comments make more sense than
human.
And that's bad. But guys, we need to move away from that.
You just started something.
I know, totally different. But let's quickly look at the discussion that is supposed to happen now.
Mm.
We are looking at the presidential election petition.
Yes.
We've had a series of these over the years, and still, well, the same party has been sued time and time again. Now, the National Unity Platform, former presidential candidate, has gone to court, indeed, still about a presidential election petition. He's saying he needs the election annulled, the January 14th election annulled. And we have seen, we're supposed actually to speak to one of his lawyers, Anthony Wameri. We still have a bit of some technical issues, but if we can speak to him, we will. I want to pick your mind on these things. We've seen that as much as these petitions have been taken to the Supreme Court, and I'm glad we have Darren here who has some low veil on him, we have seen the Supreme Court has not actually annulled any, in history, it has not annulled any presidential election. Do we see any chances of this happening? I want to first pick Darren's low mind.
There are many things that come to play here. I mean, very many people are asking questions of, in the first place, if the opposition does not believe in the system,
mm-hmm.
why are they going to court?
That
is one of the questions that keeps coming up. But
yes.
what you don't understand that in law is you're trying to set what they call a precedent.
Yes.
What has happened in the past, can it affect today?
Mm-hmm.
Or you're building a library of habits.
Yes.
For example, if I wanted to accuse the system of saying we have a failed legal system,
mm-hmm.
that's why I'll go back
yeah.
and say, you remember that in 2006 we went to court for this. Do you remember that in 2011 we went in court for this? Do you remember in 2016 we went to court for this?
Mm-hmm.
And you said the same thing, that yes, there were irregularities.
But
Darren, I'm sorry to cut you short. We have Counsel Anthony Wameri online. Counsel, good morning and welcome to the show. Hello, Counsel. Technology things I've been talking about. We will definitely get to him and speak to Anthony Wameri on that. Please go on.
So what I was saying is that there is now a record. Things have been put on record that every time they go to court, yes, the judges, all of them agree. By the way,
mm-hmm.
it's on record
mm-hmm.
that yes, there have been irregularities
mm-hmm.
in these elections.
Mm-hmm.
And then they also advise on what should be done
yes.
in the next elections.
Yes,
the question then comes back, have these things been done? That's why I said
they
build
yes.
a library.
Yes.
So over time, they'll keep saying, at one moment, they'll say, the reason why we don't believe in this mm-hmm. system is because the system itself has advised that we do this,
but
nothing has been
done.
Yeah. So it again punches holes into the system over and over again.
Yes.
But whether anything will change, we don't know. We don't know. The judges have an independent mind. They have to exercise with what they agree with, and
mm-hmm.
remember they are always nine, or depending on the court, but the Supreme Court is at nine, so it must be it's a question of the majority agreeing on which side they will agree with. Mine is not always to, because I know either way they are going to agree on something. My question is, do they then take the advice that is given to the Electoral Commission and the parties involved.
Yes.
For example, you need reforms on this, you need to curb on this, you need to do that. Why then aren't those things paid attention to
mm.
or getting changed? But yes, I don't believe, okay, I don't want to, you know, lead the conversation in what is going to happen in court. But the truth is, a decision will come out.
Definitely.
A decision will come out of court. Whether it will be a Kenyan affair where
there was
election.
One woke up and said, let's annul this kind
uh-huh.
of thing,
mm.
Or maybe you never know, the constitution may be amended and we go the Tanzanian way, where we do not petition,
you don't petition
results. You just never know what happens.
Here. Seka, do well, I'm sorry, I almost made a bad statement. Sorry. Mm-hmm. So you've been covering the National Unity Platform and you still are, you know, as we've gone. Do you think they have a case, really? I don't want us to discuss the whole case, but I want to give us a picture of, do they really have a case?
You know, this is not the first time, you know, we're seeing a petition of a kind. It has been happening, you know, where Besigye has been taking himself into court.
It's a chorus.
It's a chorus, really, so to speak. And, of course, it's the same question that has been asked by Noob several times by journalists, that, you know, you guys, you know, winning this case. And then they're very determined. They're saying that everyone, you know, you can try and then see what comes up. And then they're not even looking at, okay, they want to win. That's what they're looking at. But then, they're keeping their, you know, choices or chances open. They're saying that, okay, we might not win, but then at the end of the day, we're going to expose these people. Mm-hmm. Okay? The world is watching because they're saying they have all the evidence that they need. And I think several have seen the courts, you know, not you know, ruling in favor of the petitions because there's lack of evidence. Mm-hmm. But Noop is saying this time round, they have the evidence. Mm-hmm. They are collaborating with parties like ANT, collaborating parties like FDC and former presidential candidates.
Yes.
So they think this time round they have got enough evidence. Mm-hmm. And then it's going to be in their favor. So we just need to wait and see.
Everyone wants to win.
We just need to wait and see what comes out of this case. But of course, they're very optimistic.
Okay, let's speak to Councillor Anthony Wamere. Good morning, Councillor. How are you? And welcome to the show.
Good morning. How are you? And how are you to all our listeners and viewers?
Wonderful. We're glad you joined us. We are looking at election petition, the presidential election petition before court. And we are seeing that previously there has not been any annulment, which you are calling for, among several other reasons. We've also seen that there's some reforms that were not worked upon. And we don't know. Noob and opposition parties seem not to have any confidence in the judiciary, but you have run to the judiciary now. How does that change anything?
Well, I think to begin with, we may not have confidence or enough confidence in the system or the court, but we have enough confidence in the cause. And I think this is a genuine cause that we want to actually legitimize by doing the right thing. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, one would have thought of other means that are unlawful, but we chose to be non-violent, we chose to be law-abiding, we chose to follow the constitutional mechanisms that have been provided. Number two, you know that the justices 5 years ago made directives, not even recommendations, but directives to Attorney General, and which directives they did not comply with. So that, I think, should be the beginning and docking point on whether we actually had an election or we just had a sham. Mm. So we believe that with the evidence we have, both what happened on 14th and what transpired throughout the entire process, I believe we have something to put the justices, and since they are also Ugandans, we should be concerned about this generation and the generations to come, they should do the right thing.
Okay. Council, in the last ruling, that is 5 years ago, the justices did mention that the Attorney General ought not to be a respondent. And I think you ignored this time.
Well, we have reasons why we have included the Attorney General. We have particular claims that probably did not transpire the other time or the other people did not explore. Mm-hmm. But from the pleading that we have in court and the evidence we are going to adduce, there are some particular acts or omission that you can only push through with the Attorney General on court. And you also know that the Supreme Court can make a decision and also can go against its own decision because it's not bound by its earlier decision being at the same level.
All right.
Okay, Council, how far have you gone? You're saying that you're finding challenges serving President Museveni, the petition. How far have you gone?
Well, I tried the whole of yesterday to find the big man. I could not until I I managed to get through to Honorable Justin Kasule Lumumba, who I think has communicated with him. And as far as I'm concerned, anytime he or his duly instructed lawyers will appear at the Supreme Court and will serve them at that point.
Okay, and do you have enough evidence? We are seeing that parties like FDC aren't joining you. Are you trying to corroborate, you know, evidence from these people that sort of can win this case?
Definitely, we have enough evidence. We wouldn't have filed if the evidence wasn't enough, or even putting in more. We will get affidavits, or we have affidavits from several players within and without Uganda. And then, as you know, even some of the grounds that would have led to annulment of this election are ongoing. For example, the kidnaps of supporters and party members of National Inter Platform and Chagulanyi as an individual. Mm-hmm. We have people being kidnapped, we have people being arrested and declaration forms taken away from them. All those are grounds sufficient to annul an election, and they're ongoing. It means we could have evidence flow in until the last point when we probably have to make submissions in court.
And we've seen NRM was lined up about 20 lawyers. How many is, you know, Noob fronting?
Well, I don't know whether it's about numbers.
Okay.
But we have enough lawyers to present all the ground. There are really many, and it is the team is growing every time. We have well-wishers. We have those in the background. Okay. Those will be on the forefront. Those will be in the middle. But we also have almost an equal or even more number of lawyers on our team.
And is former presidential candidate Kizza Besigye joining you in this case?
I believe in due course you'll have this evidence in court if all goes according to plan, but we hope he can do that.
Okay, also, I would just like to ask quickly, you know, initially there were mixed messages coming from the Noob camp on whether to actually go to court or not. What changed your mind?
I don't know whether it's what changed their mind or what led to our decision, because it's a debate that we have had, and like I started, we agreed that since we started the process of participating in the elections, right from aspiring to candidature to election to petitioning, I think we have to go all the way. And number two, it's an opportunity for us to lay bare what actually transpired across the country. You realize that we had a lot of communication problems, or a lot of communication breakdown, but we managed, especially through YouVote and other means, to store enough evidence that we probably want these judges to look at. Maybe they did not see what happened in those other areas, another part of Uganda. Another thing is, for example, the judges have probably not investigated the National Voter Register to detail, and that's what we want to show. We want to show that there are some voters in that voter register that ought not to be there. There are some polling stations of that voter register that need not be there, and all those facts should be put there before the judges. And the only thing to do that is for us to go to court. If Chagulani doesn't do that, if he doesn't go to court, then he will ultimately become a media person speaking about facts that he can never substantiate. Yet in court, he will have a chance.
Yeah, but what happens if you actually lose this case? I mean, we've had people petition against the NRM win over the years, and they have not, you know, won the case. So what happens? What's the plan?
The struggle continues. The struggle continues. I remember Uganda Cranes played for 38 years before they came out. So did Liverpool in the Premier League. So we the struggle continues from day one when we set ourselves to change the leadership, to change the people power from individuals to the people themselves. I think we shall continue legally and peacefully with no violence until we are liberated.
I was actually going to ask the same question, but the way I was going to bring it out was Robert Chagulanyi is on record saying that by May, the President Museveni will not be sworn in, he will be the president by May. And I was wondering, what means are we going to use here? Just in case, you know, court does not rule in favor of Robert Chagulanyi. If you say no violence and there's legal action, I'm wondering where is the. How are we going to go about this?
I think it's not very clear. The way he talked about is this one, that I want to announce the election, we go for a by-election, and then he will be in State House by May.
Wow, interesting. And also, I'll ask a follow-up question. Suppose you actually win this case. What? Because, you see, Noob has about 61 MPs, and then opposition combined, it will be a little bit over, I think, 150. NRM has over 300 members of parliament. Then what are you going to do? How are you going to run a government where the MPs, most of them come from the NRM?
You see, at the end of the day, the beginning point is you first win. All those people are very well-intended Ugandans, just under bad leadership. So once the leadership is good, all of those people are potential and good legislators for the cause and for our posterity.
Hey, yes,
Anton, I want to, let me call you counsel or land friend, because we share the same, but I would like to come to it. You know, when you talk about evidence, I was scared at first when I watched one of the opposition members who was, he appeared somewhere on another television, and he said that your candidates in the parliamentary tickets, or, you know, those who represented you on that level, instead they paid more attention to their vote, to their DR forms, and forgot about the presidential DR forms. And somehow they couldn't even follow up where the DR forms are. So when you say that the DR forms were confiscated from the agents, and yet when they asked here if a member who was standing on the ticket and said, hey, first wait, let me first get my things done, we shall talk about the presidential forms, because this is on record. And if you have such people who didn't pay attention to the presidentials, to the candidate, your candidate is formed, how are you then accusing the state for taking them away when there's no one to guard them? And why didn't you actually form a coalition then of agents, you and the opposition parties? I thought that you guys would come together as your agents come and gather for you those forms. What happened? They were only concentrating on their bid. But here we are. You now say that the state took away your forms. How are you even getting this evidence if your own people didn't even care about your forms?
Now, first of all, it's important for us to know and separate roles. Mm-hmm. If someone is contesting for member of parliament, as a member of parliament, he has his own team, and the president also had his own team. And in some places, you would find that there are two teams, and in other areas, they shared the agents. But what is most important is, if you read our petition, we are not even asking the court to declare Chagulani winner. What we are saying is, Chagulani won, but the circumstances prevailing at the time could not even allow that win to translate or to be transmitted from the polling station to the National Tally Center. And that is why we are talking about physical confiscation of declaration form. Whether that happened at that particular polling station or in that constituency or not, the fact is that there are people who are still in police cells because they were found with the declaration form and they were charged with inciting violence. We also have it on record that police took some declaration forms and returned them in photocopy form, and not all of them. So that's a fact that you cannot take away. What is important is that in this election, we are pointing out the irregularities right from the roadmap or the aspiration up to the time actually as we speak now. So cutting across, you realize that even for the non-presence or the absence of agents at the polling station was caused by the state operatives that could not allow them to operate in those particular areas. So we'll traverse all those. We're not basing largely on the declaration form. Where we are basing on the declaration forms, we are only arguing the fact that we could not even peacefully have our declaration form. Finally, if the Electoral Commission and government says you cannot even have a parallel tally center, then what's the importance of a declaration form? Because the importance of a declaration form is once I get it, I get another from another place, I combine and tally, then I know what I have before I can even make a claim. And that was not possible because our offices were sealed off up to now.
And also, you know, we've heard of the stories of, you know, what happened during elections. I mean, the internet was switched off. We could not access photographic evidence. Of course, you've told of certain things about arrests, you know, taking place. Certain forms were torn, and you know, all these things that have happened. How is it going to be for you to present hardcore evidence? Because, you know, you may get to court and you have all these wonderful stories, and yes, the judge may actually listen and agree, but to actually prove that the law was broken and, you know, you were maybe sabotaged from winning this election. How easy is it going to be for you to prove this case?
Two things. Much as internet was off, but the cameras were working. The cameras were working, the eyes were working, the ears were working. People were seeing, they were hearing, they know what transpired, and they saw that in evidence, and they've come up in hundreds, by the way, to adduce that evidence, and it's admissible in court. But also, two, and most importantly, we're not looking at 14 in isolation. We are looking at the entire process. We are looking at what transpired throughout the campaign, what transpired, what the army and the military and the police did, and I think when we put all that together, we're able to gather enough evidence. For example, it's on record, and we shall present the videos where President Museveni was saying that I'm going to finish Chabunanyi's team. And after 3 or 4 days, he arrested 100 members of the presidential candidate team, which is still languishing in prison and undergoing trial in the court martial. So we have enough evidence to show that not only 14th, but the entire process was a sham.
All right. Council, in conclusion, as we wind up this conversation, really, thank you for making time. We have seen critics actually saying that Uganda has the structures and the procedures in place to enable election petitions to allow for redress when election malpractice has occurred. But this is more likely to occur in the High Court than the Supreme Court. I know the Supreme Court handles the presidential election petitions, but then there is that worry that it is easily addressed in the High Court. Did you explore that option?
No, we couldn't, because this is what the law is. The law is that the election petition on the presidential election should be in the Supreme Court, and that's the final court in determining that matter. We do not have any other option but to go to the Supreme Court, and we believe that the 9 or 7 justices that will sit in that matter are able to rightly think, and we hope that they will do that and deliver what the Ugandans need, that is justice and that is fairness.
Absolutely. I hope we can dispel those worries.
Can you just educate us about something here? A fellow counsel, or maybe he's not yet at the bench, Mabirizi. I'll just go back to when they were, just amended the constitution, and he carried forward and said, no, let me go to the East African Court. Can you educate us the role of the East African Court, just in case? What could happen? Can the East African Court do something about the decision that can be carried out at the Supreme Court in Uganda?
Well, there is not, if someone really needs a tangible remedy, the regional and international courts are not one of those places that you'd expect much, but at least you expect things in form of sanctions. You could expect stuff like sanctions. You could expect stuff like parties, the state parties talking to each other and trying to cool them down. But if you really want a hard and tangible result, then the Supreme Court has to do this, or it may never be done.
Yeah, okay. For a last question from me, we've seen that NRM has lined up to 20 lawyers, seasoned lawyers, and we see some big names in their list. Are you in any bit intimidated by the other, your challengers?
Be fast. That's the last thing we'll do. That's the last thing we'll do. Some of us are hardcore. I think this is not even a very, very big case like one would want to put in. There are more cases where we have been involved, and one would be more scared than this one. And number two, it is this is not wrestling. You see, with wrestling, when you have people like Golola Moses, sometimes the out of ring words tend to. I mean, this is the law. This is evidence. This is, and we have all been to law school. We have floored these people in many instances. So I think what is important is the cause, the evidence, and what the law says, not about how many. That's why we are not even. There are people now, I think, that will never come out, never even know that they are part of this team, but in the background, they are working around the clock, and we have confidence. We couldn't hear anyone.
All right. Thank you very much, Anthony, Counsel Anthony Wameri. Thank you very much for making time, and we wish you the best of luck.
Thank you, dear. Have a good day.
Great day too. All right. And that actually winds up the day here for us at Urban Today. Thank you, ladies. Sometimes I forget. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll definitely catch you again tomorrow. We have lots of conversations going on. Schools are reopening. Are you ready? You need to think about that. It is Cancer Month. Have you thought about that? Yes. So we need to prepare you for that. So we will take, now we'll take our leave. Go and take some breakfast. Take care of yourselves. Coronavirus is still here. Wear your mask and sanitize as often as you can. We'll catch you again tomorrow. Good morning.
Urban Today, brought to you by
Metropolitan International University, we offer postgraduate diplomas, bachelor's degree, diploma, certificate programs, weekend, day and evening. Registrations in progress at our campuses.